तो आप एक साइड में बैठ ही सकते हो गया। कुछ सेकंड डिले होता है ना सर। अभी ठीक है सर। डिपार्टमेंट
हिमाटोलॉजी। मैं लिख लूँ, आई विल राइट, मैं लिख लूँगा बाद में। Respected teachers, presenting my topic today, that is clinical features and diagnosis of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. This is the outline of my presentation, that is introduction, classification, systemic manifestations, then hemorrhagic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, then pregnancy morbidities, neonatal APS, then when to suspect and test for antiphospholipid antibody, diagnostic criteria, then catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, then FEL carriers or silent carriers, then seronegative APLA. So, as all of us know, APLA is a multisystemic autoimmune disorder characterized by vascular thrombosis in arterial, venous, and microvascular bed with or without pregnancy morbidity associated with clinically significant persistent antiphospholipid antibodies. So, coming to classification of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, it may be primary or secondary. 35% of secondary antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is usually associated with SLE. So coming to clinical classification, it can be thrombotic APS with predominant thrombotic manifestations, or can be obstetric APS with APS defining pregnancy morbidity, or catastrophic APS with rapidly evolving multi-organ dysfunction or seronegative APS. So coming to secondary APLA, SLE comprises the most common cause of secondary APLA, with 22 to 50% of cases of SLE having antiphospholipid antibodies, followed by Sjögren's syndrome, rheumatoid arthritis, ITP, psoriatic arthritis, multiple systemic sclerosis, then mixed connective tissue disorder, polymyalgia rheumatica comprising 20%, Behçet's syndrome, then some infections like syphilis, hepatitis C, HIV, HTLV, malaria, sepsis, then some drugs like phenytoin, procainamide, amoxicillin, interferon alpha. All these like infections and drugs, they can also associated with transient antiphospholipid antibodies. Coming to the clinical spectrum, APL positivity can be there without any clinical events or clinical manifestations, with annual risk of thrombosis of around 1.86%. So a person can be silent APL carrier, or there may be APL positivity, that is antiphospholipid antibody positivity, solely with non-criteria manifestations, non-clinical criteria manifestations, that is there may be persistent thrombocytopenia, hemolytic anemia, cardiac valve disease, then APL nephropathy. There can be classical APS with thrombosis, with or without pregnancy morbidity, with typical lab-defined criteria. It can be also catastrophic APS, and it can be seronegative APLA. Coming to the clinical manifestation proper, thrombotic manifestation can occur in venous, arterial or microvascular rate. Systemic manifestation can affect any system, that will be discussed subsequently. And pregnancy morbidity can affect either there can be either maternal complication or fetal complication. Coming to thrombotic events, deep vein thrombosis of lower limb, this is the most common clinical manifestation, usually affecting 20 to 30% of cases, followed by pelvic vein thrombosis, renal vein thrombosis, then adrenal vein thrombosis leading to hemorrhagic infarction and subsequent Addisonian crisis, then pulmonary vein thrombosis, hepatic venous thrombosis leading to Bocelli syndrome, portal venous thrombosis, axillary vein thrombosis, then subclavian vein thrombosis, ocular vein thrombosis, cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, inferior vena cava thrombosis, and superficial vein thrombosis of the skin also detected and reported. Then cerebral, coming to the arterial circulation, cerebral vasculature are the predominant target of this arterial thrombotic events leading to stroke or transient ischemic attack. There can be retinal arterial involvement and coronary arterial involvement leading to coronary artery disease. There can be renal artery thrombosis leading to renal infarct, and mesenteric arterial thrombosis leading to bile ischemia and subsequent bleeding and acute abdomen. Then risk of recurrence is there. The annual recurrent thrombosis risk is around 5 to 12%. And after first unprovoked venous thromboembolism, the annual risk of recurrent venous thromboembolism can be much higher, ranging from around 10 to 20%. Lupus anticoagulant and triple APL positivity confers high risk for recurrence and increased susceptibility for thrombotic events. Coming to the neurological features, vascular thrombosis and direct neuronal injury by the antiphospholipid antibodies are the mediated mechanisms. Ischemic stroke or TIA, either due to in situ thrombosis or embolism, are the most common manifestations. Entity known as Sneddon syndrome with widespread livid reticularis in association with stroke and detectable antiphospholipid antibodies is also detected. There can be cognitive deficits, there can be dementia due to multifocal white matter involvement or vasculopathy. There can be epilepsy, cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, then involuntary movements in the form of chorea, hemivalismus, transverse myelitis, multiple sclerosis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, sensory neural hearing loss, orthostatic hypotension, then migraine, psychosis and depression. All these are the clinical neurological involvement comprising the neurological spectrum of APLA. Coming to hematological manifestations, there can be unexplained persistent thrombocytopenia, which is usually moderate, doesn't cause severe bleeding. This thrombocytopenia is usually immune mediated. It can be also due to formation of antiphospholipid antibodies against platelet membrane phospholipids. There is also direct platelet activation and aggregation leading to thrombocytopenia. There is also autoimmune hemolytic anemia, bone marrow necrosis due to diffuse microvascular thrombosis, then thrombotic microangiopathic syndromes, often recognized as microangiopathic antiphospholipid syndrome or MAPS, comprising the spectrum of either TTP, HUS or HELLP syndrome, and catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is also recognized. Then as all of us know, thrombosis is a predominant manifestation of APS, but there are some reports of severe fatal hemorrhage also in case of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. That is, major bleeding, it occurs in nearly 10% of the patients, and the most common cause or mechanism of APL-induced bleeding is diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, most probably due to capillaritis. Then adrenal hemorrhage, due to adrenal vein thrombosis leading to hemorrhagic infarction. Then lupus anticoagulant hypoprothrombinemia syndrome, that is, in this case there is formation of non-neutralizing antibodies against factor 2 or prothrombin, leading to rapid clearance by reticuloendothelial system with subsequent depletion of prothrombin and bleeding manifestations. Then there is persistent thrombocytopenia due to multifactorial causes, as we have discussed already. Then catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome and other causes of thrombotic microangiopathies. Then fulminant sepsis, disseminated intravascular coagulation, excessive anticoagulation, surgery and invasive procedures. All these are the major factors which comprises and contribute for major bleeding. Coming to pulmonary manifestations, pulmonary thromboembolic diseases, pulmonary arterial hypertension, pulmonary arterial thrombosis, then pulmonary microthrombosis, acute respiratory distress syndrome, then diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. These are the spectrum of pulmonary manifestations in APLA. Then coming to cardiac features, there can be non-bacterial vegetations known as Lippmann Sachs endocarditis with changing murmurs, most commonly affecting or predominantly affecting the mitral valve followed by aortic valve. There can be accelerated atherosclerosis and coronary artery disease, which is actually twofold increased in case of antiphospholipid antibody associated syndrome. And it is higher in patients with lupus anticoagulant and IgG anticardiolipin antibodies. Coming to dermatological manifestations, there can be livedo reticularis, which is most common dermatological manifestation. It should be differentiated from livedo racemosa. Then there can be splinter hemorrhage, there can be cutaneous necrosis, infection, digital gangrene, skin ulcerations, skin nodules, then vasculitic lesions, then antiderma and thrombopoietis. Coming to the difference between livedo reticularis and livedo racemosa, livedo reticularis can be physiological, can be pathological, but livedo racemosa is always pathological. Livedo reticularis is usually blanchable, but livedo racemosa is partially blanchable. It is having livedo reticularis has reticulate morphology, it is diffuse and symmetrical, but livedo racemosa has a branched morphology, and it is localized or can be generalized also. And the most common morphological difference is livedo reticularis, as we can see the picture below, it is usually symmetrical and forms a complete circle. But livedo racemosa, it has usually a branched morphology, and there is incomplete or broken circle. That is, it is broken, there is a broken pattern of livedo. So this is the typical picture of livedo reticularis. Then this is the antiderma and anitoderma. Anitoderma means there is loss of focal elastic tissues in the skin, leading to skin friability. As you can see, there is focal loss of elastic tissue. And coming to renal manifestations, acute or chronic renal failure with or without proteinuria and hypertension. There can be renal infarct or renal vein thrombosis. Coming to GI features, there can be bilateral ischemia, perforation, there can be GI bleeding, either upper GI bleeding or lower GI bleeding, there can be abdominal pain, acute abdomen, then giant gastric or atypical duodenal ulcerations, splenic or pancreatic infarction is also reported in case of antiphospholipid antibody associated syndrome. Then coming to hepatic manifestations, hepatic or portal venous thrombosis, that is Bocceri syndrome, hepatic veno-occlusive disease, hepatic infarction, portal hypertension and cirrhosis is also recognized. Coming to ophthalmological manifestations, amaurosis fugax, retinal venous and arterial occlusion has been reported, anterior ischemic optic neuropathy. Then adrenal manifestations, either unilateral or bilateral adrenal venous thrombosis leading to hemorrhagic infarction is also reported. It is seen in 13% of cases of catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. It presents as acute abdomen in the form of either abdominal, lumbar, pelvic or thoracic pain. Then coming to skeletal manifestations, avascular necrosis or osteonecrosis is the most common manifestation, either per se may be due to antiphospholipid antibody induced or maybe due to treatment, that is most probably due to steroid induced. Then coming to the difference in clinical feature between primary and secondary antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, SLE associated APS are more likely to have arthritis, livedo reticularis, heart valve disease, thrombocytopenia and leukopenia than patients with primary APS. Frequencies of arterial thrombosis, venous thrombosis and fetal loss were greater in patients with APS and SLE than in those with primary APS. So as all of us know, this is the SLEEK classification criteria for systemic lupus erythematosus. There is clinical criteria followed by immunological criteria. And as we can see, all the clinical manifestations, those are compatible with SLE, can be compatible with antiphospholipid antibody syndrome also. And even if in immunology criteria, there is also a criteria for testing antiphospholipid antibodies. That is, in every case of SLE, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is recommended for evaluation at baseline, and all the clinical features should be evaluated accordingly and correlated accordingly. Coming to pregnancy complications, it can be maternal in the form of either placental insufficiency, preeclampsia, eclampsia, HELLP syndrome, or fetal complication, either earlier late term fetal death, premature birth, intrauterine growth retardation, intrauterine fetal death, or neonatal APS. So these are the proposed mechanism for APL mediated fetal loss that was published in BJH, that is intraplacental thrombosis leading to placental insufficiency, then inflammation, interference with annexin 5 function, inhibition of the syncytium trophoblast differentiation and defective placental or placental apoptosis, then complement activation. Coming to neonatal APS, that is, it is due to transplacental transfer of maternal anticardiolipin antibodies and anti-beta-2-glycoprotein antibodies, mostly IgG variety. But some cases of IgM-mediated neonatal APS has also been detected due to subsequent de novo formation of IgM in the neonate, maybe due to a septic challenge. So it is usually associated with some risk factors in more than 60% of the cases in the neonate, whenever there is thrombosis like arterial or venous catheters, sepsis, asphyxia, inherited thrombophilia. APL can also APL in neonate can also cause neurologic dysfunction in the neonate. So neonates born to mothers with APS should have close neurodevelopment follow-up. So these are the effect of APL antiphospholipid antibody during pregnancy, that is recurrent early miscarriage, late fetal loss, gestational hypertensive disorders, that is early onset preeclampsia, eclampsia, HELLP syndrome with or without preeclampsia or eclampsia, oligohydramnios, and early delivery. 30% of children born to mothers tested positive for antiphospholipid antibodies during gestation acquire these antibodies passively. And the clinical implication is there can be either prematurity, intrauterine growth restriction, then fetal distress, fetal and neonatal thrombosis, developmental delay, or behavioral or cognitive neuropsychological impairment. So when to suspect and test subsequently for antiphospholipid antibodies? So in appropriate clinical setting, when one or more unexplained or recurrent venous or arterial thrombotic events in young patients, that is males less than 55 years and females less than 65 years, with absence of any identifiable risk factors and thrombosis at unusual sites, then they should be suspected for APLA and tested accordingly. Then thrombotic microangiopathy of unknown etiology, one or more specific adverse outcomes related to pregnancy, either late trimester or recurrent miscarriage or premature birth, then severe early preeclampsia, then systemic autoimmune diseases in the setting of appropriate clinical symptoms, all cases of SLE at baseline should be evaluated for antiphospholipid antibodies and should be managed accordingly. Then unexplained mild thrombocytopenia, persistent mild thrombocytopenia, unexplained incidental prolongation of APTT, unexplained adrenal insufficiency, pulmonary hypertension, history of a false positive serologic test for syphilis. That is, all these should be suspected accordingly tested for antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. So this is the revised SAPPHIRE classification criteria, which requires either a thrombotic or a pregnancy morbidity criteria followed by with a laboratory criteria. So thrombosis, there may be arterial thrombosis, venous thrombosis or microvascular thrombosis that can be either confirmed by imaging or by biopsy. And pregnancy morbidity, that is unexplained miscarriage more than 10 weeks of gestation of a morphological normal baby, morphological normal fetus, and premature birth before 34th weeks of gestation due to eclampsia, preeclampsia or placental insufficiency. then more than 3 unexplained consecutive miscarriage less than 10 weeks of gestation without any anatomical, hormonal or chromosomal alteration in both the parents. That is, chromosomal abnormality of both the parents must be excluded in the presence of either lupus anticoagulant, that is according to the diagnosed according to ISTH guidelines, then anticardiolipin antibodies more than 40 GPL or MPL, and anti-beta 2 glycoprotein antibody more than 99th percentile with a standardized ELISA test 12 weeks apart in a clinical significant or persistent titer gives a diagnosis of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Then coming to catastrophic APS, it is a rapidly evolving multi-organ dysfunction, usually characterized by diffuse microvascular thrombosis. There is evidence of involvement of 3 or more organs, organ systems, and development of manifestations simultaneously or in less than a week, with confirmation of histopathology by small vessel occlusion and laboratory confirmation of the presence of antiphospholipid antibodies. Whenever there is presence of all these 4 criteria, then it is defined as definite catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. But there can be probable catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome when there is 2 organ involvement or absence of laboratory confirmed antiphospholipid antibodies, when there is fulfillment of criteria 1, 2 or 4 or 1, 3 or 4 with development of a third event more than 1 week but within 1 month of presentation despite anticoagulation. So this catastrophic antiphospholipid antibody syndrome usually develops in less than 1% of the cases of APS, and the mortality rate is around 50%, and the most common triggering event is either sepsis or infection, and surgery or any invasive procedures. And the differential diagnosis is either DIC, fulminant sepsis, then thrombotic microangiopathy like HUS, TTP, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, malignant hypertension, and HELLP syndrome. All these needs to be excluded. Then conditions associated with antiphospholipid antibodies. Apart from primary APS or secondary APS, in where there is persistence of clinically significant persistent APL titer, SLE and other collagen vascular disorders, some drugs like chlorpromazine, phenytoin, hydralazine, then quinine, alpha interferon, amoxicillin, oral contraceptives, propranolol, then solid tumors, Hodgkin's and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, myeloproliferative neoplasms sometimes, then myeloid and lymphocytic leukemias, then infections, mostly bacterial, viral and parasitic, even malaria. And nearly 5% of cases of healthy population, they harbor this antiphospholipid antibody syndrome even without clinical manifestation of APS. So they should be followed up accordingly. Coming to seronegative APS, this was an article published in Hematologica in 2020. So it is a clinical manifestation highly suggestive of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. So when there is clinical manifestation highly suggestive of APS in the absence of laboratory criteria of detectable APLs, it should be diagnosed as seronegative APS, but we should be very cautious, and it is a diagnosis of exclusion after excluding all other causes of thrombophilia. So these are the extra criteria clinical features which should be kept in mind, that is dementia, seizures, multiple sclerosis like lesions, chorea, myelitis, livedo reticularis, then Lippmann Sachs endocarditis, diastolic dysfunction, thrombocytopenia, which is persistent and unexplained, then hemolytic anemia, microangiopathy, chronic vaso-occlusive lesions. So all these lesions should be non-criteria clinical manifestations, should be remembered, and after excluding all other possible causes in respective clinical scenario, we should search for antiphospholipid antibodies. And sometimes the typical antiphospholipid antibody profile that we are using, they can be missed, and these extra criteria antibodies can be also associated with either pregnancy morbidity or thrombosis, that is anti-prothrombin antibodies or phosphatidylserine antibodies, anti-annexin 5 antibodies, antibodies to vimentin or cardiolipin complex, phosphatidyl ethanolamine, phosphatidic acid, phosphatidyl inositol, and IgA. Sometimes IgA anti-cardiolipin antibodies and anti-beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies also are also implicated in thrombosis. But at present, all these antibodies are not recommended for testing, and it requires a highly sophisticated laboratory infrastructure, and the testing methodology is also yet not standardized. So this is the diagnostic algorithm, that is, we should have a detailed history of a particular patient with nature and frequency, risk factor of thrombotic events, pregnancy outcomes, family history of thrombophilia, and features relevant to SLE or other connective tissue disorders and thrombocytopenia, followed by detailed physical examination for ischemia, infection, gangrene, or livedo reticularis, then deep vein thrombosis, or any cardiac murmurs, or any associated neurological abnormalities. We have to then correlate these physical findings with the history and go for subsequently proceed for repeal testing with ELISA and lipos anticoagulant. Simultaneously, we have to evaluate for thrombophilia of other causes, unexplained cytopenia, causes of other autoimmune diseases or connective tissue disorders. Then heparin-induced thrombocytopenia should also be considered in all cases with appropriate clinical context. So these are the differential diagnoses that is causes other than other causes of thrombosis, that is inherited and acquired thrombophilia should be excluded in all causes of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. That is factor 5 leading mutation, protein CES, antithrombin 3, then anatomical or vascular obstruction apart from thrombosis, then occult malignancy, then PNH, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, then myeloproliferative neoplasm, thrombotic microangiopathies, then other causes of transient APL that we have discussed, that is infections, malignancy, drugs, rheumatologic causes, DGS. All these should be kept in differential diagnosis of APS. Then causes when APS patients, they present with recurrent pregnancy loss, then parental and parental both maternal and paternal chromosomal abnormalities must be looked into, and anatomical abnormalities also must be excluded. Then endocrine disorders such as hypothyroidism is also a differential diagnosis. Thank you. Now Dr. Salim will brief us about the treatment modalities of antiphospholipid antibodies.
Good afternoon, teachers and colleagues. Can I start?
Yes.
I'll be dwelling upon the treatment aspect. This is just to show you the prevalence of antibodies which has already been covered. The first thing is primary thrombus prevention. Usually the APL testing is done as part of evaluation for SLE, recurrent pregnancy loss, thrombocytopenia, livedo reticularis, unexplained prolonged ABDT, positive screening test for syphilis as already told by the previous speaker. So whenever we get a positive APLA test in any of these clinical settings, now the next question comes to our mind is whether we have to prevent that first thromboembolic risk. Is it really required and what is the risk? We'll go through the literature. This by study by Pengo et al. In Italy, where they enrolled around 179 patients with APLA. There is only single lupus anticoagulant positive in these patients. They have excluded the other double or triple positivity. Here the demographic features, if you can see, the associated autoimmune condition SLE was in around 26%, and risk for arterial thrombosis and venous thrombosis was in 40% and 34%, and lupus anticoagulant testing was as per the criteria. So when they followed up for almost 3 years, what they found was only 7 people developed the thrombosis, out of which 4 were venous and 3 were arterial. which was not statistically significant, and also few patients who were on aspirin for conventional cardiovascular risk factors also did not show any statistical significant protection against thrombosis in this study. A second study which was done parallelly by Pengo et al. In Italy, in which they had enrolled patients with triple positive, that is all the three antibodies are positive, to see the risk. So out of this 104 patients, the SLE patients constitute about 13%, and the risk of other thrombosis were in 33 in arterial and 29 in venous. When they studied this, almost 25 people over a period of this is time of around 4.5 years of follow-up, and almost 25 people developed thrombosis, out of which 12 were arterial, 11 were venous. When compared results of both the tests, the annual incidence rate with only lupus anticoagulant was 1.3%, whereas for triple positive was 5.3%, and the cumulative incidence were almost increased to 5.9% 10 years for only lupus anticoagulant, and triple positive was 37.1%. So this actually shows that there is definitely a risk with lupus anticoagulant, and but however these two studies did not show any protection with aspirin, maybe of lesser numbers. Let us see whether is in the subsequent studies was there any benefit. So in this second study by Pengo et al., when they did multivariate analysis, the male sex and risk factors of VTE were independent risk factors of thrombosis in these subgroup of, in these patients. So whether only APLA is enough to cause the thrombosis or an additional risk factor is also required to cause APLA is what was thought of. In the APLASA trial, this was the first randomized trial which was for intervention, where aspirin was given for 1 arm and against placebo. And in the same study, who did not enroll for APLASA for the RCT, they were just observed in the aspirin and non-aspirin group. What they found out was all except one patient with thrombosis had concomitant thrombosis risk factor. So there is always an extra risk factor, whether it is an arterial, venous, or a systemic autoimmune disease. And asymptomatic persistent APL positive did not benefit from low dose aspirin, and because here the primary outcome, if you see, of thrombosis was in the control arm rather than the in the intervention arm than the control arm. So there was no any thrombosis seen at around by about 3 years in any of the placebo groups. Hence the trial was stopped. So the vascular events when additional risk factors are there was inferred probably the thrombosis is mainly due to the an additional risk factor which is present. When we compared the earlier trials where definitely there was a risk, but however when we compared with the therapeutic modalities, the aspirin has not prevented any of this thrombus. In another meta-analysis done by L. Arnold et al., where he almost 11 studies were taken into consideration, where they what they have seen was, if you see the forest plot, it was favoring an aspirin. With subgroup analysis, they showed almost 50% reduction in the thrombosis in aspirin group. But however, when they closely went through each of the study, there was no significant risk reduction as well when considering only prospective studies and those with the best methodological activity quality. And also the ERCON 207 RCT trial, which I told that the APLASA trial, which I told you, was also did not show any benefit of aspirin. So it was more of benefit in arterial and SLE and obstetric APS, few subgroup analysis. In another prospective study in a 3 year of 170, in earlier studies only few patients were actually required any low molecular weight heparin or aspirin during high risk periods. But in this study, almost 178 patients out of 404 patients, 178 patients were given low molecular weight heparin or aspirin during high risk periods of prolonged immobilization surgery, and it actually translated into no episode of thrombosis. So it's a this has to be kept in mind. So these are the APL antibody risk profile by ULR 2009. This has been earlier also told by Dr. Gurpreet and Dr. Tribhikram. So coming to the guidelines now, we have seen the evidence. Now coming to the guidelines, the British Society of Hematology does not recommend any thrombophlebitis prophylaxis in asymptomatic APL incident patients who are detected incidentally. The Cochrane review tool also tells the same. David Garcia and Durek Erkan in their review article in NEJM 2018, they also recommend no thrombophlebitis with low dose aspirin. However, EULA 2019, based on that meta-analysis, recommend low dose aspirin in recommended high-risk APL profile, either with or without SLE. Low dose aspirin may be considered in SLE with low-risk APL profile. Since we all have seen in the previous speakers have told that the risk of thrombosis is increased in an associated autoimmune condition, especially in SLE, goes to the tune of 5%. So probably, since EULAR mainly deals with systemic autoimmune diseases, so they have recommending low-dose aspirin with a high-risk APL in upfront setting and may be considered in low-risk APL profile. Most important is also the general measures which have to be kept in mind, because most of these patients also have other cardiovascular risk factors and venous thrombosis risk factors. If you miss out on this, probably you may link the thrombosis to the APL. So you have to strictly screen for all these cardiovascular risk factors, and also if there are any risk factors, then appropriate intervention has to be done. And use of low molecular weight heparin has to be given in special situations such as surgery, hospitalization, prolonged intervention, and perfusion. They have not said whether it is to be high risk APL or low risk APL. Overall, all groups will benefit, but however, high risk APL group will benefit more. Before going on to the venous thrombosis, that is for secondary prevention, some general measures have to be told to all the patients, like they should counsel on the treatment adherence. INR monitoring is very important, because most of the patients will be on oral anticoagulation, and use of perioperative bridging therapy with LMWH for patients on oral coagulants, because if they don't know how to do it, and probably if it is not done properly, we have seen that it can precipitate catastrophic Apla syndrome. Also, oral contraceptives are harmful, not to be used in such people. Pregnancy and postpartum period has to be taken care of. Postmenopausal hormonal therapy is not recommended, and lifestyle modifications has to be part of this, because all patients will go on to the age of elderly, and then if they can have coexistent cardiovascular risk factors, so they have to do life, because if any additional cardiovascular risk factor will add on to the thrombosis, which you have seen in the earlier study. So one, already if somebody is APL positive, they should go for strict lifestyle modifications. Coming to the conditions where already a venous thrombosis has occurred, and now to prevent for the secondary prevention, all the guidelines say you have to start with an unfractionated heparin or low molecular heparin initially, and followed by a vitamin K antagonist, because initially the bridging is required, and an INR of 2 to 3 has to be maintained, and long-term anticoagulant therapy in unprovoked cases. Probably nobody has clearly told how much long-term, but it is mostly a lifelong as of now it has to be considered. And short-term for provoked, like if there is any provoked incidents, like any surgery or immobilization or any infection, if an APL patient develops a thrombosis, in that situation it should be followed by the other international guidelines, where for VT, where it has to be only for 3 months, and then weigh the risks of recurrence. They also seen whether high versus conventional warfarin was beneficial. The trial done by Kawathar et al. Did not show any difference between the low intensity and high intensity warfarin. A similar study by Finazzi et al. Also did not show any difference between low intensity and high intensity warfarin. Also, it has increased to hemorrhagic risk. Though the major hemorrhage is not more, but however, there is definitely a theoretical risk of higher hemorrhagic complications with high intensity warfarin. When it comes to recurrent venous thrombosis, despite adequate INR is being maintained, first thing is we're not jumping to the treatment part. We have to ensure we take again history properly, that whether the patient was adhering to the vitamin K antagonist properly, and also the INR monitoring was regular, and see if these things are you are sure that you have done these things, and despite that and you have seen that INR was in therapeutic range and patient was adhering, then you will have to consider whether adding a low dose aspirin or a high intensity warfarin dosing 3 to 4 or change to low molecular heparin if the patient is affording. Now coming to arterial thrombosis and APS, as already the previous speakers told, the arterial thrombosis is more in case of APS than the venous thrombosis, the incidence wise. The study in the VARS randomized trial and the APA study, initially the 2,206 patients were randomized to taken into the study in the warfarin versus aspirin. And out of that, 1,710 patients were tested for APL antibodies, so to see whether an APL antibody has any bearing on the recurrent thrombosis or the treatment. So what they have seen was both in the warfarin and aspirin group, the recurrent thrombosis rate was almost similar. So either you choose warfarin or aspirin has actually not made any difference in this VARS trial. Also, they have seen if there is any particular antibody profile has got any high risk of thrombosis. The Kaplan-Meier curves does not show any statistical significance. However, with the double positivity, there is extra risk. These studies were done prior to the revised Sapporo classification. So here, the anticoagulopin and LA were done. The limitation of the study was the APL was tested only once, and the titer was taken as cutoff was 21, whereas the new guidelines take a titer of 40. So probably we would have got more number of positive tests in this rather than if the new criteria. And also what they have concluded in this trial was, since there was no any correlation between the APL and the stroke, so routine testing of any patient in stroke is not recommended unless it is age less than 50. The other observational studies also seen the high recurrence of with APL, and highest risk was seen with less than 50 and triple positive. Mostly the high risk of occurrence with APL was more to do with additional risk factors, and they recommended treatment with long term warfarin. So with this background of evidence, whether to go ahead with warfarin or low dose aspirin, so the British Society of Hematology doesn't recommend routine screening of all ischemic patients unless they are less than 50 years. For unselected stroke patients, both are equally effective. Hence, antiplatelet therapy is preferred on grounds of convenience, because warfarin has got an additional risk of bleeding as well as the tight monitoring. And young adults less than 50 years with ischemic stroke and APS may be at high risk of recurrence. And the cohort study suggests that anticoagulation with warfarin should be considered. But however, there is no strong evidence, because there are no randomized trials which has proven that. Warfarin is better than low dose aspirin. So the ULR 2019 recommendation also say that in definite APS and first arterial thrombosis, treatment VK is recommended irrespective of the age. But the other agencies of the stroke people, mainly they differ in this, and they would go with the aspirin only. Treatment with VKA, the INR 2 to 3 or 3 to 4 is recommended, and basically we have to weigh the individual's risk of bleeding and recurrent thrombosis. Treatment with VKA with 2 or 3 plus a low dose aspirin also may be considered in special situations, or if you find there is a risk of thrombosis, rethrombosis is high. Based on the pooled data from two retrospective studies and two RCTs, they did not see any statistical difference between the VKA with a target INR of 3, 4 or 2 to 3, similar to what they seen in the venous thrombosis. So warfarin with 2 to 3 is what is initially recommended, and later on, depending on the risk of the recurrence, the INR can be increased to 3 to 4. So, coming to the direct orally acting anticoagulants, mainly the NUACs, earlier in the guidelines the DUACs were there, but now there is enough evidence that it is inferior, the DUACs are inferior to warfarin in APS. So this is a meta-analysis of 47 studies comprising of around 447 patients who received DOACs, and 73 patients had developed recurrent thrombosis after a mean period of 12.5 months. In the river, the factor Xa inhibitor 16.9% and the factor II inhibitor dabigatran that is 15%, and triple for positivity this they have seen that fourfold increase of recurrence was there, and arterial thrombosis and DOACs had increased risk of recurrence. These were the observations of this study, and clearly saying the risk of recurrent thrombosis was statistically significant. In the TRAPS trial by Pengo et al., around 120 patients were enrolled. It was randomized to rivaroxaban and warfarin with triple positive. Only they have seen only in the high-risk profile how it will evolve. The thromboembolic events occurred in 12% of the rivaroxaban arm, where there were no thrombotic events in the warfarin arm at a mean follow-up of 19 months, which led to the early closure of this trial, and the major bleeding also was around 7%. The ASTRO-AP study comparing apixaban and warfarin is still underway. They have stopped recruiting, but the results are yet to come. Based on this evidence, the guidelines has been revised, and the BS, British Society of Hematology, in its 2020 amendment has told DOACs are not recommended. However, if patient wants to continue with informed consent, you can continue. And the EULAR 2019 also doesn't recommend DOACs now in APS. Coming to other treatment strategies, now the biggest problem in thrombosis and APS is that the recurrent thrombosis, the risk of recurrence is very high. You've seen in the studies also. So the other agents which can be used still evidence is not adequate, but they have seen in smaller observational studies that statins and hydroxychloroquine have helped. And also, if you go back to Dr. Goodfried's presentation, she's also showed the complete pathophysiology in that NEJM article 2018, where statins and hydroxychloroquine could be beneficial, and hydroxychloroquine can tackle the toll-like receptor cytokine pathway. And now at this state, the statins and hydroxychloroquine are recommended in recurrent arterial or venous stroke, but not as part of standard recommendations. Rituximab is also advocated, but not for thrombotic APS, but for hematological manifestations and TMA. This is based on few case series. Coming to catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome, the entire clinical picture was told by you by Dr. Trivikram. I'll only concentrate on the treatment part and the main precipitating factors is the infection, surgery, and discontinuation of anticoagulation in the APS patient. So that's why I was telling the patients have to be educated on the bridging when they have to switch from oral anticoagulation to low molecular heparin during periods of perioperatively, or because if they don't do it properly, there is a potential risk of getting a CAPS. And so hence prevention is very important here. So early diagnosis and management of infections, minimization of discontinuation of anticoagulation, low intensity of anticoagulation. Because if you don't prevent this, if you get into situation of CAPS, the mortality is high in treated patients. In untreated patients, it is almost near fatal. The general principle of treatment in CAPS is that it's early diagnosis and aggressive therapy is the key. We have to address the thrombotic events and suppressing the cytokine cascade. The treatment will involve anticoagulation, high-dose systemic steroids. We have to pulse with methylprednisolone with anywhere between 500 to 1 milligram to 1,000 milligram for 3 days, and followed by prednisolone 1 mg per kg. And plasma exchange has shown benefit. 3 to 5 plasma exchanges of one volume minimum have to be undertaken to see any benefit. And their studies have shown that there is a considerable decrease in the APL antibody titers. And also, followed by plasma exchange, IVIG can be given as an adjunct. And IV antibiotics have to be given if there is any suspicion of infection. In refractory CAPS, eculizumab has been tried in few cases, and these case reports have shown promising results. Because, and also in recently in ASH 2019, it was presented that the complement activation in CAPS was presented, and also if you recall the presentation of Dr. Gurpreet, where she has shown beautifully on the NEJM article where the cascade of complement activation occurs. So eculizumab is a potential target, and it has shown promise. Probably it will require more studies to establish and to come as a standard of care. And next, rituximab was used in a review of 20 patients where it has helped, and because you see mainly the antibodies are produced by the B cells, and rituximab targeting the CD20 B cells, so will definitely help in these situations. The non-criteria manifestations have been told you by Dr. Trivikram. I will not go into them in detail, but however, how to manage these non-criteria manifestations. Sometimes you can have only non-criteria manifestations and don't have any APLA antibodies. This is what a limitation of this new new classification, Sydney classification. So probably in future the risk scores are being made to incorporate these things, if at all this is a area of research for future. In the cardiac disease, if there are no evidence of any systemic embolization, that means that if you don't have features of any endocarditis but only the leaflet thickening is there, it is preferable to give a low dose aspirin. But however, if the vegetations are there and systemic embolization risk is there, like if a patient comes with a history of TIA or anything, low dose aspirin has to be done. But if you have a TIA or anything, then you have to add anticoagulation as well. And in myocardial infarction without atherosclerosis, anticoagulation is recommended. And neurological features other than the stroke, low dose aspirin is controversial, and antiepileptics have to be given for seizure if you have a strong suspicion that it is. And coming to the hematological manifestations, thrombocytopenia is the most common manifestation. Mostly it is not less than like severe thrombocytopenia. It is usually between 50,000 to 1,50,000, which generally doesn't require any treatment. But however, we have to rule out other possible causes of thrombocytopenia, like TMA, drug-induced thrombocytopenia, or the heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. In asymptomatic patient with more than 30,000, we can do a wait and watch strategy. But if in symptomatic patients less than 30,000 or some patients with bleeding, treat like ITP. Here, patients with ITP and APS, we have to avoid splenectomy if you are having suspicion of the chronic ITP or refractory condition, because the surgery can precipitate catastrophic APLA syndrome. So rituximab has to be tried before. And hemolytic anemia, if you are with cystocytosis, you should rule out a TMA, and if it is a TMA, you should treat like a TMA with plasma exchange, corticosteroids, and plus minus rituximab. If you have without cystocytes, then we will have to look for autoimmune hemolytic anemia, and treatment will be as per AHA. The safe anticoagulation in thrombocytopenia, if the platelet is more than 50,000, is safe. But however, if you have patients with 30,000, and if you are giving treatment which can increase the platelet count in the near future, and if the patient is at a high risk of thrombosis or already has a thrombosis, there you can start even at 30,000. But the risk of bleeding versus thrombosis has to be looked into. Coming to the renal manifestations, mainly the anticoagulation is the cornerstone, and also sometimes they can have rapidly progressing renal failure in acute kidney injury where you have to resort to plasmapheresis or corticosteroids. Even if patients have gone into end stage renal disease and on hemodialysis, still they are also at risk of thrombosis, so we have to continue anticoagulation. And even in post renal transplant setting, you have to continue anticoagulation. Now coming to the obstetric APS, in a retrospective study, they have seen in obstetric APS in non-pregnant state, if the patient qualifies for the obstetric APS but presently non-pregnant, is there any risk of any thrombotic event? So they have seen that there was almost 10.4% risk, so there is definitely a risk. So in patients of such patients, like pregnant patients with obstetric APS in non-pregnant state, low dose aspirin is recommended by the EULAR 2009. But however, some groups say that low dose aspirin may not be given, because you have seen in the other studies also, which I have quoted in the beginning. All the studies have shown there is a risk, but however, no study could prove that loaded aspirin was able to prevent any thrombosis. In women with high risk APL profile but no history of thrombosis or pregnancy complications, treatment with low dose aspirin during pregnancy should be considered. In women with history of obstetric APS only, no prior thrombotic events with or without SLE, but the combination treatment with LD and heparin at prophylactic dosage has to be given during pregnancy is recommended by the ULR 2019. But continuation of heparin at prophylactic dose 6 weeks post delivery also should be considered in these cases. Non-criteria obstetric APS, like where the lab criteria are not being not the lab criteria, but the criteria for the obstetric APS where the fetal loss less than 10 weeks, more than 10 weeks, and less than 34 weeks, if those are not meeting exactly, but they are classified as non-criteria obstetric APS, in that patients also, if you have a APL positivity, treatment with LD alone or in combination with heparin might be considered based on the individual risk profile. In women with history of thrombotic APS, combination of low-dose aspirin and heparin at therapeutic dosage has to be given. In women with criteria obstetric APS with recurrent pregnancy complication, despite combination treatment with low-dose aspirin and heparin at prophylactic, like in the earlier thing where they don't have a thrombosis, but during pregnancy they have to give prophylactic heparin, but if they develop any pregnancy complication, then the heparin has to be increased to therapeutic dose, or you can add HCQ or low-dose prednisolone in the first trimester. And use of IVIG may be considered in highly selected cases. Now coming to some issues with anticoagulation, APDT, when patients are on unfractured heparin, mostly LA doesn't interfere with APDT monitoring, but however, in 5% of cases it can interfere, and hence you should have a baseline value before starting the heparin. So if you have a prolonged baseline, then that can be used to titrate your dosages. But the best way to do is a chromogenic factor 10 assay, but that is presently not available, routinely available for routine clinical practice. It can also cause problems with PTINR monitoring. Presently there are a lot of reagents, thrombolytics, which are insensitive to LA, but however, if places where you get baseline PT prolonged, then you have to resort to specific thrombolytic reagent which is insensitive to LA, or follow the manufacturer recommendations or for the correction, or you can go for chromogenic factor assay. And regular monitoring INR is tedious, there can be compliance issues, and there can be bleeding complications. There can be issues with testing of APLA antibodies, which has already been dealt with in the previous first presentation. Now coming to prognosis in antiphospholipid syndrome, the mortality in APS is almost 9.3%. In the study, this is the longest study, almost 10 years follow-up study by Kevara et al, where they have seen almost 1,000 patients. They have seen almost 93 patients died. Mainly the cause of death were arterial venous thrombolic events, stroke, myocardial infarction, pulmonary embolism, and CAPS. Few succumbed to bacterial infection and bleeding as well. What is the road ahead? Though there is risk stratification based on the antibody profile, but however, in the studies it has not translated into any sort of therapeutic benefit, whether intervention with high intensity warfarin or prophylaxis, at any stage it has not translated into a therapeutic benefit. So the risk stratification models have to evolve. And few models that GAPS was initially told by Dr. Gurpreet in her first presentation, and more research is ongoing, so better define, and then in the clinical trials it will be used, and then that can be used for clinical practice. In primary prevention, though we have seen the HCQ and statins have got some role, but however they have not been formally studied, so they have to be studied so that low-dose aspirin is not effective. Hence, addition of any HCQ or statins at primary prevention level, is there of any benefit, is a future question. Coming to secondary prevention, The optimal duration of VKA in provoked thrombosis is still not, because though we are following the as per the normal guidelines for any other VT, but however the risk of recurrence of thrombosis is high in case of APLA patient. So we need to actually do more studies and see what is the actual optimal duration in these patients. And VK plus HCQ in first arterial thrombosis, similarly what I have told, have to be studied at every stage, because now presently we are using statins and HCQ only in recurrent thrombosis state. And is there any way to look at discontinuation, because lifelong anticoagulation is not easy, telling is easy, but doing it or for the patient it is actually very depressive. So can we have any model on discontinuation of VK in patients who actually become negative for APL? And also targeted therapies like B-cell depleting rituximab, it is showing promise, but however there are no adequate studies to bring it as a standard of care, and complement inhibitors, mTOR inhibitors in recurrent arterial thrombosis, because the recurrent arterial thrombosis is more than the recurrent venous thrombosis in these patients, and this is a major concern in treatment of APLA, and also it is translating into significant morbidity and mortality. The role of HCQ and statins, vitamin D, other platelet inhibitors has to be looked into. And coming to obstetric APS, the safety of low dose aspirin, heparin, and HCQ presently, low dose aspirin and heparin is the standard of care. Whether adding HCQ will further benefit or not. And efficacy of 150 mg versus the 100. Presently, the low dose aspirin what we are using is less than 100 mg. Most of the studies are using 81 mg. So whether you use low dose aspirin or in that place, we can use 150 mg. So if a randomized trial can be done and see whether it translates into better clinical outcomes. And the safety of efficacy of statins, like already mentioned in the other scenarios. Thank you. Is there any questions? Questions?
So coming to Dr. Asif's question, what is the prevalence of in what percentage of cases only extra criteria antibodies or clinical features are present? I was going through a paper of Frontiers of Immunology that was being published in 2018. The name of that particular paper was Prevalence of Non-Criteria Antibodies in Patients of Antiphospholipid Antibody Syndrome, those who satisfy typical diagnostic criteria of APS, that is thrombotic or pregnancy morbidity. In that particular study, they have found that less than 1% of cases were positive for non-criteria antibodies, but there was no strict definite inclusion or exclusion criteria as far as that particular study is concerned. And in another Chinese study, there was around 18% of cases of patients, those who were positive for non-criteria antibodies. But basically, there is no general consensus what are the non-criteria antibodies profile in different studies, and what are the inclusion and exclusion criteria. So there is a large study variability and outcome variability also. So few studies also report that there is 0 to 70% chance of association of IgA anticardiolipin antibodies and anti-beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies in different papers. So as far as Indian data is concerned, on our subset of patients, considering the ethnicity and our geographic and environmental profile, data for our subset of patients is not available. And for clinical features of non-criteria clinical features, I couldn't get any particular paper showing what is the exact fraction, but it is quite prevalent as far as this neurological manifestations and anemia and other features are concerned. And we may be missing or underestimating them and should be clinically suspected in appropriate setting. Thank you. Thank you.
if there aren't any questions, thank you very much for a patient hearing.